We have a diabetes epidemic on our hands. Global rates of diabetes have doubled over the last three decades, and more than 800 million adults now live with diabetes. One thing that's often put forward as a possible solution are low-carb diets. And that seems to make sense if diabetes is a state where we have trouble processing, digesting carbohydrates normally, then restricting the carbohydrates in the diet seems to make sense. But in science, we always need to test things. Hypotheses are just that. So a team of scientists set out to investigate this exact idea. They enrolled a group of people living with type 2 diabetes, and they advised them to start eating a low-carb diet. How low-carb? Very low-carb. If our body doesn't get enough carbohydrate in the diet, we produce what's called ketone bodies that our body can use for fuel in the absence of carbs. This is why we call very low-carb diets ketogenic diets, because they generate ketone bodies. So the team of scientists aimed for this physiological range, which usually requires under 10% of our energy, of our calories, coming from carbohydrate. And for reference, the average Westerner and most diets out there get about 40, 50, 60% of calories from carbs. So a ketogenic diet is a pretty radical carb restriction. And the main thing they were using as a metric were their diabetes parameters, specifically hemoglobin A1C, or glycated hemoglobin. And this reflects the average of our glucose levels over 3 months, and the normal range of hemoglobin A1C is under 5.7%. If it's higher than 5.7 but lower than 6.5, we say the person is pre-diabetic. And if it's 6.5 or higher, we say the person is diabetic. So the average hemoglobin A1C of all the participants before the study was 7.5. So that's extremely high, clearly in the diabetic range. And that's on diabetes drugs. A lot of these participants were taking medication to help lower their blood glucose level. And still, it was this high. Okay, so what happened on the diet? After 1 year of the program, the average A1C of the participants was 6.3%. So that's under the threshold for diabetes. The average of all participants is. And bear in mind, this is with a lot less medication. Most participants dialed back, and many even stopped taking diabetes meds. So there was a substantial drop in A1C, even though they were taking a lot less meds. One out of every four participants was under that diabetes threshold without any medication. So this is what we call remission. The person is no longer diabetic naturally without the help of medication. Out of these, about 25% of participants, about half were now in the pre-diabetic range, so they're now pre-diabetic, and the other half, slightly more than half, were in the normal range. So this is what we call complete remission, having a normal hemoglobin A1C without medication. So this is a very encouraging result. One out of four participants not diabetic anymore, one out of eight participants completely in the normal range and without taking any medication. Now, these were the results after 1 year of the program. One of the best things about this study, this is called the VIRTA study, after the company that ran the program. And one of the best things about this study, and something that I respect that the investigators did, is they didn't stop there. They didn't rest on their laurels. They kept following the participants up to a total of 5 years of follow-up. And so at the five-year mark, 20%, one out of five participants, are still in remission, still under that diabetes threshold without medication. Out of these 20%, about 13% were in the pre-diabetes range, and 6 to 7% had normal hemoglobin A1C, what we call complete remission. Now, these are the numbers looking at the completers, only the participants that finished, that went all the way to the five-year time point. If we look at all the participants who started the program, so including anybody who dropped out or gave up, then the numbers look a little worse. By the five-year mark, 14% of all the participants who started the study were in remission, and about 5% were in complete remission. So this is a really interesting data set, and I think it can teach us a lot. First realization is that clearly this program worked for some people. I've seen people on social media hate on keto, say that this is poison and nobody should ever be on these diets. I don't really understand that. When you see somebody with type 2 diabetes, which is a very serious condition, And by changing their diet, in 1 year they can be in remission. They can essentially not be diabetic anymore, kind of solve the problem. And some people maintain that up to 5 years at least. That's as long as we know. Why would you not have this on the table for some individuals for whom it works? By the same token, it's obvious from the numbers that the program didn't work for everybody. The majority of participants were still diabetic by the five-year mark. The vast majority, over 90%, it seems, were still either diabetic or pre-diabetic. And if we look at the average of these metrics at the five-year time point for all the participants, this is even more obvious. The average A1C at the five-year mark was 7.2. So it improved significantly in the first year, but then with time, they gradually got worse again. They rebounded. It's still lower than it was at baseline, so it's not like they lost all their gains, but it's extremely high again. And if instead of A1C we look at fasting glucose, same trend. The average before the study was around 158 milligrams per deciliter. That's extremely high. Normal glucose, fasting glucose, is under 100. After 1 year of the program, the average was a little over 125, so that's right under the cutoff for diabetes, which is 126 fasting glucose. But then after 5 years, back up to 151, almost back to baseline. And by the way, this type of rebound is very common to see. This is almost routine in all kinds of dietary trials. It's not specific to keto. We see this with all types of diets. And it's probably because people struggle to adhere long-term, to sustain the habits. They can do it for 6 months or a year or something like that, but then long-term, they struggle to maintain it. So clearly, this program doesn't fix diabetes for everybody. It's not a panacea. It's not going to single-handedly fix the diabetes epidemic. But then again, I don't think any single diet is going to do that. And bear in mind, when we look at these results, that this study was very well designed in terms of giving the participants the best chances of success. They were given a lot of resources. They had a dedicated app where they recorded all their metrics and they got a lot of information and education from the app. They also had contact with a coach and a medical professional, either a doctor or a nurse, through the app regularly. They also received equipment from the research team to track their metrics. They got an electronic scale, a glucose, and a ketone meter. Also, this program was designed and supervised by some of the leading experts on keto diets, some of the academic researchers that have published extensively on this topic and who believe this diet or are excited about this diet. So this setup is completely different from me randomly saying, I'm going to try a keto diet because I heard about it, and trying to do it by myself without this support system and all these experts and all these resources. And another thing that's absolutely critical is this study, the VIRTA study, was not randomized. It's not a randomized trial. These participants chose to go on a keto diet, chose to join this program, chose to do the keto diet. So there's an element of motivation there that's massive in these type of interventions, because people already come into it excited about, or at least open to the diet, to the specific diet, to the specific program. That's completely different from a randomized trial where you randomly split participants and you tell them, hey, you go on diet X and you go on diet Y. They didn't choose it themselves, right? So bottom line, in a randomized trial or in real life, just a random person doing it by themselves, you expect much worse results, all else held equal, than in this, let's call it, ideal setting. So the program, the diet, is not a fix-all for everyone, or for most people, even long-term, but it does work for some people. It works really well for some people. There's no contradiction, right? This doesn't have to be cookie cutter. We've covered a lot of studies, randomized trials, using other diets and putting diabetes in remission. I know the temptation is to compare these head-to-head and come up with the winning diet. You can't really do that because the designs are so different. Comparing a randomized trial to a study like this that isn't randomized is not a very informative comparison. But what we consistently see for all of these studies is they all work for some people. There's always a percentage of participants who achieve remission on all of these diets. None of them work for everyone. And we see that rebound pretty much always. So those are common themes. I know what's popular and what's viral is to say that there's one diet to rule them all. And if you're not doing it, you're killing yourself. That gets a lot of clicks. People love clicking on that type of stuff. But that's not supported by scientific evidence. And I don't think that's going to solve the real problem that we have in the real world. Another crucial lesson from this data set is the problem with anecdotes, because a lot of the discourse online is around anecdotes and personal stories and these kind of flimsy narratives. And what we see in general with these diets, with any diet really, is those individuals who succeed, whatever percentage, 10%, 10, 20% of people, whatever the number is, who do well on a diet, who do well on some program, they become the evangelists. They start the blogs and the podcasts, and they start calling themselves low-carb Steve or low-fat Mike or keto doctor and stuff like that. And they insist that this is life-changing. This diet is the right diet. Why isn't everybody doing this? And they're not lying. They're telling you the truth for them. And so if we get our scientific information from a Facebook group or a community on the internet, it looks like all there is a success because those are the people that are in there very vocally sharing their excitement. We don't see the 80 or 90% or whatever the number is of people who failed because they're usually not there. They're usually doing some other diet in some other Facebook group. Also, remember the rebound, right? Even among those people that did succeed on the diet, that got really exciting changes over 6 months or a year, a chunk of those people are going to rebound over time, right? So the anecdotes in the Facebook group tend to not give us all that information, tend to kind of obscure the picture. So this is why we need data sets. This is why we need science. So we can look at things big picture. It's kind of an unbiased approach, and we don't have all this selection bias from the internet and these communities. So my takeaway from everything I've seen on this question is we offer people a variety of options, all designed to be healthy. So a lower carb diet, maybe even a keto diet, designed to be healthy. I wouldn't do the bacon and lard internet version, but you can do low carb. You can even do keto with lots of greens, with lots of fiber, with healthy fats, fatty fish, olive oil, nuts and seeds. Now, that's not going to fix the problem for everyone. So maybe we have a carb moderation diet that's not as drastic as keto. Maybe we have a Mediterranean diet. Maybe we have a pescatarian diet, all designed to be healthy. So this way, we maximize the number of people that we can help. We lose virality. The video doesn't become viral, but that's okay. We have real impact in the real world, hopefully. If you're interested in eating a low-carb diet for diabetes or some other purpose, we have a whole video covering how to do a low-carb diet in a healthy way, in a safe way, and I'll link that right here. And if you prefer a Mediterranean diet, we got a whole video on that, how to do that safely and healthily. I'll see you in there. Take care.